Last week, we examined the perspective of Marxism in relation to ethnic inequality. Marxism sees nearly everything through the lens of someone's economic position. Today we're going to shift our focus onto Weberian theory and examine how they start to incorporate concepts of status and identity into their explanations of ethnic inequality. So today we're going to delve into the theory behind Weber and his view on ethnicity. Good morning once again. So today we're going to go through Weber and ethnic inequality. So just like last week, we're going to go through the basic and general theory of what Weberians would say about ethnic inequality. And then next lesson, we'll go into some more specific studies, some more specific concepts. Much like Karl Marx, Max Weber recognized that class was a very important distinction between people. But he argued that there were significant differences between people of the same class that could often lead to inequality. He argued that ethnic differences could be sometimes more significant than class ones. Max Weber's view of social stratification was slightly more complex. He argued that non-economic factors could also influence your position in society. He gave the examples of your status in society, as well as your political representation. So before we move on, it's probably best that we recap the three terms that Weber uses to describe someone's social position. The first is your market situation. That is essentially a combination of your working conditions and your level of pay, essentially your social class. Secondly, and this is where Weber begins to differ then from Marxists, you have status situation. That is the level of status that you as a member of a group are given by society. And thirdly, we have party situation, which is your level of political representation. So do you have a trade union that represents you? Do you have any MPs that represent your point of view? Now, the basic gist of Weberian theory when it comes to social inequality is those three terms and your level of each one will determine your position in society. You can have different levels of each one of those. So we can basically apply those three terms to explain ethnic inequality. And I'll go through each of those terms now and just talk about how ethnic inequality can be described simply by saying that ethnic minorities have less of each of those status, market, and party situations. So firstly, we need to look at how ethnic minorities can be disadvantaged in terms of their market situation. Weber argued that it was simplistic to simply judge someone's social class based on their income. He said that someone's work situation, or their working conditions, was equally as important. So when we apply Weber's concept of market situation to ethnic minorities, we can see that they are disadvantaged in both of the measurements of what determines someone's social class. Firstly, they tend to have lower incomes in relation to the white majority. They also tend to have harder working conditions than the white majority. Both Weber and those that have succeeded him would argue that has a profound impact on their life chances when compared to the white majority. Now, I was curious about this and I wondered what evidence there was of the claim that ethnic minorities have a lower income on average than the white majority. I found in government statistics that the black population is the most likely to live on an income of less than £400 a week. And then I did some digging into the work conditions claim. Now, this was a bit harder to find, but a study from the TUC found that the black community were far more likely to be employed in insecure work. Two of their main findings were that the black community are over twice as likely to be in temporary work than the average population. They also found that the proportion of the black community in zero-hour contracts is 5%, which equates to about 1 in 20, whereas the national average is 1 in 36. So we can see that their working conditions are far more insecure than the rest of the population. So market situation is an important component of what makes up your social position. If you think about how pervasive someone's social class is in relation to their education, in relation to their housing, then it's an extremely important part. But what makes Weber unique in his position on ethnic inequality is his addition of the extra two concepts, particularly his addition of the use of status. So status situation is the amount of status that your group has been given. And if you recap what we were doing with social class, we remember that status groups will show off their status through status symbols, and they'll also close off their status through social closure. So this is exactly the same and can be applied to ethnicities. So status situation is the second part of the formula that makes up someone's social position. For Weberians, modern societies are characterized by status inequality as much as they are by economic inequality. The same is true of ethnicity, as ethnic groups will act like any other status group and try and maximize the privilege that their status is given. The core way that ethnic groups will do this is through practicing social closure, which is the act of closing off a status to other members of the society. Ethnic groups will do this through prejudice and discrimination. This acts as a form of social closure, as it prevents the ethnic minorities from attaining the same kind of status as the ethnic group that you are a member of. So when we apply this to society as a whole, we can see that this concentrates power in the hands of the ethnic majority, as they will close off their status to the ethnic minorities through prejudice and discrimination. It's important to recognise that Weberians argue that all of these terms will interplay with each other, so having a low status situation makes it harder to compete for jobs, and therefore affects your market situation. So status situation has a very important role in determining your life chances.
Would anyone like to share with the bigger group which privilege they chose and why they think it's interesting?
The privilege I chose was I can ignore the social issues of people of color and remain largely unaffected by the negative consequences.
I am very rarely asked to speak on behalf of all the people of my racial group.
I can choose nearly any profession without questioning whether or not a person of my race would be accepted in that profession.
I can continue to live my life without thinking twice about anything, and it's just kind of shocking to think about that.
So whether knowingly or not, we're always acting in terms of our status group. Everyone is a member of a certain number of status groups. It might be based on your occupation, say if you're a doctor or a teacher. But everyone at the end of the day is also a member of an ethnic group, which can also be classified as a status group on a larger scale. So just like any other status group, everyone within that wants to try and maximize the amount of privilege that their status is given. And one quite obvious way of doing that is from excluding others from getting the same status through racism and discrimination. Now, sadly, the implications of that are that ethnic minorities are always going to be essentially in a lesser status than the ethnic majority, simply because there's more of them. And so ethnic majorities holding the kind of reins of power will be able to have more control over how much status they are given. Now, that might seem fairly complex as a theory or as a concept, but its bottom line is this. Ethnic minorities not only suffer from economic inequality, as we've already illustrated, but they also suffer from status inequality. So a middle-class ethnic minority is going to still be considered a lesser status than a white middle-class person, because they have different levels of status according to their ethnic group. So think of it as just kind of one big competition that we don't necessarily know we're taking part in, where we're all trying to show off that our status is the more important one.
Do you know who I am?
No, I can't say that I do.
I don't know how to put this, but I'm kind of a big deal.
But the final component that we need to look at is political representation, also known as party situation. A third aspect that can raise or lower your social position is how well represented you are in politics. Some examples include how well trade unions represent your point of view, Or are there any pressure groups that push forward any issues that relate to you? Do you have a good number of MPs which are pushing forward your point of view at the highest level of government? Now, many Weberians would argue that on all three of those fronts, ethnic minorities suffer inequality. Let's take the example of trade unions. Trade unions are very useful in pushing forward the issues of a status group, especially in terms of their occupation. However, most trade unions are dominated by their white members, and are often led by their white members. So, in this way, ethnic minorities are excluded from having their voices heard through trade unions. The same argument could also be applied to Parliament. Although in the most recent election, there was a record number of ethnic minority MPs, it was still only 10%, whereas there are 14% population which are non-white. Therefore, you could argue that they are slightly disadvantaged in that the white majority are going to have their views far more widely expressed than the non-white population.
20-year-old student Anthony Kalu voted for the first time in a national election this year. He says it's important for young ethnic minorities to see people from their own ethnic group in politics.
It's all about who's most like you, you know. If you're not interested in politics, you want to see someone, you know, who you believe is perceived, is closer to you, whether that be through colour or be through class. Or be through gender.
Kalu says ethnic minority MPs serve as role models for black and Asian young people.
So if we had to summarise the Weberian position on ethnic inequality in a simpler way as possible, we can simply say that ethnic minorities have less market situation, they have less status situation, and they have less party situation. Now that can form three separate paragraphs in an essay. Our next lesson will have some specific studies that we can use to support those three claims. So in terms of evaluating the Weberian approach to ethnic inequality, we can see that its core strength is its understanding that there are several other factors which constitute someone's power or status in society. Just like Weber's explanation of class inequality, he does a good job of explaining the other factors which constitute someone's position, namely the status and the political representation. And the same applies exactly to ethnic inequality here. But there is a few problems with his approach. Namely, he does not really provide a method of measuring the different levels of those three situations, and doesn't necessarily give us detail as to how those three situations interact with each other. Does necessarily having a higher status situation always result in a higher market situation? We can quite safely say that racism and discrimination have decreased for the past, say, 100 years. So the status situation of ethnic minorities has certainly improved, but the economic improvement in terms of their market situation has been fairly limited. So how can we truly say that that explanation is valid? So as we make our final thoughts, as we look at Weber and we consider an overall evaluation of the theory, it's important, I suppose, to look at comparisons with the other theories that we've looked at. And that's probably the best way of evaluating Weber as a whole. It is still a structural explanation of ethnic inequality, so in that sense it's fairly similar to Marxism. You know, it does see ethnic inequality as the production of society's structure, as opposed to the culture itself. But what, again, sets apart Weber's explanation to Marxism and the other theories is his incorporation of that multi-varied analysis. You know, there's various factors, not just economic status, which come into play in determining the position of ethnic minorities. And it is still, in many ways, a conflict theory, because it does see status groups and ethnic groups as being in conflict or in competition for maximum status. So it is a conflict structural theory, much like Marxism, but its main difference is that it's slightly multifaceted. Now, the other aspect to consider here is that we can evaluate this from the perspective of consensus or culture-based explanations. They would argue that a lot of the inequalities that Weber identifies with his three situations can be explained by the actions of the ethnic minorities themselves. You know, it's their culture which essentially gives them a reduced status, which gives them a reduced market situation. So there's lots of ways that we consider this, and again, it really comes down to your personal view of the factors behind ethnic inequality. So lastly, I just want to cover some general feedback for the essays that I've read so far from your assessment on Friday. Now, point number one I just want to raise is that we need to make sure that our paragraphs are focused. Now, this might be the thing that I'll focus on in my Friday exam skills workshop, but we need to make sure that during our paragraphs we keep to one clear message, because a few of you were trying to force kind of two studies into one paragraph, or two Marx explanations into one paragraph, and it gave the impression that you were kind of going a bit all over the place. Yes, you can obviously do two studies. I encourage you to do that in my advice, but make sure that they are logically linked together. So don't just throw in two studies without any kind of logical thought behind it. Really consider if they're meant to be paired with each other before you match them, and make sure that they're both adequately explained. Because the second point I wanted to raise was avoid study dropping. Don't just throw in a study and put in the kind of general points that the course booklet might have. Try and expand on them, give them some context, give them some explanation, give an example. Really show that you not just know the study, but you also understand it and you understand how to apply it. But generally, other than that, they were really good, and they were really encouraging to read. So thank you for that so far. Just let's keep this momentum up, because we seem to be doing really well at the moment with this online learning stuff. So let's not let the momentum drop. Let's keep going full steam ahead. Okay, so I will see you on, what day is it? Monday.